hear the people sing, singing the song of angry men. It is the music of a people who will not be slaves again. When the beating of your heart echoes the beating of the drums, there is a life about to start when tomorrow comes. Will you join in our crusade? Who will be strong and stand with me? Beyond the barricade, is there a world you long to see? Then join in the fight that will give you the right to be free. Do you hear the people sing, singing the song of angry men? This is the music of a people who will not be slaves again.
All right, welcome back, A Push Scholars. We want to thank the soundtrack from the movie Les Mis, Do You Hear the People Sing? And frankly, I love that song so much. And also, I had a really hard time finding a song for this section, so I'm like, darn it, if I don't know it, I'm either going to go with Les Mis or a Disney movie like Tangled or Frozen. Okay, quick introduction to this section. Again, we're continuing period 2, 1607, Jamestown, to 1754, start of the French and Indian War. And we're starting chapter 4. This is the first half of chapter 4, pages 64 to 73. The title of the chapter is American Life in the 17th Century. Start with Jamestown. Ooh, big event in A Push. Something happened in 1692. I see it. I see it. I see them witches. And here is the quote from William Bradford from the Plymouth Plantation. Being thus past the vast ocean and a sea of troubles before in their preparation, they had now no friends to welcome them, nor inns to entertain or refresh their weather-beaten bodies, no houses or much less towns to repair to seek for succor or relief. Basically, when they came over from Europe, from England, there was nothing here, and they were on their own. They couldn't go back, and it was tough. Okay, the first section for today's reading is the unhealthy Chesapeake Law of Important Information here. I got three key questions that we're going to cover in the next slide, talking about what happened to half the people. They never lived to what age, ratio of men to women, which we actually might remember from earlier today, and why did Virginia have the largest population despite having fewer families than New England? Okay, so in the section, the unhealthy Chesapeake, and again, the first thing is unhealthy. That just shows you that they had a lot of health issues. A lot of people died at a very early age. Reminder also, Chesapeake refers to the colonies of Virginia and Maryland. Terrible living conditions, okay? Food shortages, contaminated water. It was just a filthy region to live in, especially early on in the Chesapeake's existence. We know that diseases obviously affected and killed 90% of Native Americans, but also did kill many of the Virginians as well. Malaria was one of the leading diseases. The life expectancy, key point here, was so low in this region. Half of those born in the area never lived to age 20. Okay, that is just awful. When you compare that to the New England colonies, especially Massachusetts, Massachusetts had a much greater life expectancy. The first immigrants to Chesapeake were mostly single men. We know that in Jamestown, in 1607, they were all men. But also most of the indentured servants, which greatly increased Virginia's population, most of them were men. And the ratio was nearly 6 to 1 men to women. And so women had no problem finding a man to marry. It was much more difficult men to find women, however. With that said, I'll just mention right here that women had a lot more rights in the Chesapeake region than they did in New England, and that will be covered later. There were a few families in the Chesapeake area, especially early on, because they were mostly men. But eventually, they start to develop because more women were coming over into the Chesapeake, Virginia area. And eventually, there was more reproduction going on, and then eventually more families. And although the population growth was slow, especially through reproduction, Virginia was still the number one populated colony, followed by, we know that number two was Massachusetts, and then number three was Pennsylvania by the year 1700. The next section to read is the tobacco economy. Three key questions in this reading. Why was the production of tobacco too good in the Chesapeake? And explain, what was the headright system? Key term in A Push, need to know the headright system. And by 1700, indentured servants made up what percentage of European immigrants to the Chesapeake? Okay, the tobacco economy section, lots of important information. First of all, we'll start at the top. Land of the Chesapeake was perfect for tobacco growing, leading to huge production. And production is great because the more you make, the more you can sell. However, and this is going to be a key idea throughout the history of America, overproduction. Overproduction is not good for farmers. Let me say that again. Overproduction is not good for farmers because it causes falling prices. The more that is produced, the prices that it's sold for is going to go down. And that's bad because if you're a farmer, you want to sell your crops at the highest price possible. So this idea of overproduction leads to several, and let me say again, several depressions throughout our country's existence. Overproduction of goods is not good, especially for the farmer. It causes farmers to lose their homes eventually as well. So many farmers planted tobacco in the Chesapeake to sell over corn to eat, okay, because they knew how profitable tobacco was for them, and it basically was the staple crop in the Chesapeake. And the corn was not going to be as wealthy of a product for them to sell. As we mentioned a lot, the main source of labor in the 1600s in the Chesapeake was indentured servants. Okay, these people were the main labor force, not African slaves. That change happens in the late 1600s and continues throughout the 1700s. All right, key term, the headright system in APUSH, must know. Virginia and Maryland especially use this system to bring over indentured servants. And so here's how the headright system worked. A rather wealthy, typically, person in Virginia, a plantation owner, would pay the passage for an indentured servant worker. And so the voyage over from Europe costs money, and so that voyage for the worker would be paid for by the Virginian planter. And the planter, or the wealthy Virginia landowner, would receive 50 acres of land for every person they bring over. So what is the result of the headright system? Well, the rich are getting richer. They are getting more and more land for every indentured servant they bring over. And when you have more indentured servants coming over, the poor are getting poorer because these indentured servants are constantly in debt. Can I get a wow? Roughly 100,000 indentured servants were brought over to the Chesapeake by 1700, and it was just terrible lives. Terrible lives to be an indentured servant. It wasn't quite slavery. As bad as slavery, however, they were forced to live and work for a person for up to 4 to 10 years of service. A lot of times the food they ate was very, very poor quality, not enough, and it was very tough living. In fact, many of them died before they were able to serve their terms of service up. And the key thing is the indentured servants were not happy for the most part because of this indebtedness. And it produced a restless population. And when people are restless, when people are unhappy, rebellions tend to happen. Okay, here's a quick visual of the headright system, must know in APUSH. Indentured servants coming to the Chesapeake colonies. Their trip on the ship across the Atlantic is paid for by the wealthy Virginian landowners. And the wealthy Virginian or Maryland landowner would get land, 50 acres of land for every person they brought over, and they would still get the indentured servant for them to work for them for between 4 to 8 years. Okay, next section, frustrated freemen and Bacon's Rebellion. We talked about in the last slide how the indentured servants were a restless population, always trying to pay off their debts, unhappy because they were so poor and had very little land. The two questions that we're going to look at include: what was the main cause of Bacon's Rebellion, and what was the major results of Bacon's Rebellion? And of any event in colonial period, I think Bacon's Rebellion is the most important one, even more important than the Salem Witch Trials. Wow. Bacon. All right, continuing with this section, Frustrated Freemen and Bacon's Rebellion. The frustrated freemen, that refers to the former indentured servants. They used to be indentured servants for 48 years, but now they were free. And they had a hard time getting land, and they were unhappy about that. And Bacon's Rebellion is probably the biggest colonial event in APUSH that we need to know. And it really begins in the year 1676, and this is a key year. I would highlight, underline that. Thousands of restless men, most of them were indentured servants, or used to be indentured servants, were drifting about the backcountry in Virginia looking for land. And so they were struggling, and they looked for somebody to help them with their misery, and the leader becomes a man named Nathaniel Bacon, who arrived in Virginia in 1673. He was a relatively wealthy landowner in Western Virginia, and he helps organize a rebellion. The question is why? Why did Bacon organize the rebellion? Because they felt the colonial government led by the Governor Berkeley back east towards the Atlantic Ocean was not representing the Western planters and that Governor Berkeley didn't allow the Western planters to attack the Native Americans. So there's a lot going on here, but basically it's a struggle between the western parts of Virginia, the farmers out west, who tended to be more poor, many of them used to be indentured servants, versus the eastern elite. And typically the wealthiest people of the counties were close to the Atlantic Ocean along the eastern seaboard. So Bacon is unhappy and leads an army of 1,000 east of Jamestown, and so a civil war develops over Virginia. It's Nathaniel Bacon and his former indentured servants versus Governor William Berkeley and the eastern elite. And Bacon is able to actually burn down Jamestown during this year. All right, here's a couple images of Nathaniel Bacon. And again, he looks kind of like an aristocrat, but you need to know for a push that he did lead indentured servants and former indentured servants in an uprising against the eastern elite in Virginia. Okay, continuing with Bacon's rebellion. So Bacon does burn Jamestown down. However, he dies, unfortunately, from dysentery shortly after taking over Jamestown, and his forces fall apart. The English military comes in, gains control of Jamestown, and they basically crush the rebels, and they hang over 20 of them. So Bacon's rebellion fails. So let me say that again. Bacon's rebellion is a failure. However, it is very significant, and this might be the most important part of the rebellion. Okay, so the rebellion showed the continuing struggle to find the boundary between the Indian and white land, and that's really going to be a common theme throughout A Push, really up until the late 1800s, as Americans move further west and try to take over land of Native Americans. So that's an issue. But I think, and also it reveals the division between the east and west of the colonies. The eastern people were different in many ways than the western people, and there was always that division between them. It showed the instability in the county of the free landless men. Again, at the heart of the rebellion was indentured servants. They were a serious problem. 100,000 of them have arrived by 1700. And that was a problem for the wealthy landowners, the planters of Virginia. So they were looking, and this is, I think, it. You must know this, that Bacon's rebellion leads to the eastern planters, or the wealthy, of Virginia and the Chesapeake looking for less troublesome laborers, and that becomes slaves from Africa. So after the year 1676, most of the workers are no longer indentured servants. They become African slaves, and you see a great increase in the number of African slaves in Virginia. The next section is on colonial slaves. We have three questions. What is the African population in Virginia in 1670 and 1750? Hopefully you can take a guess at what the difference is, especially after the last section. What was the ratio of blacks to whites in South Carolina? And what was the death rate on the Middle Passage? Okay, for the 200-year period from 1600 to 1800, so right before Jamestown to right after America, the United States of America was formed, 10 million Africans were brought to America. And most, and this is an important point, this could be on our quiz or on the test, most actually were brought to South America and also the West Indies, so not to, when we think of North America today. The population of Virginia in 1670, only 7% of the Virginia population was black in that year. 1676, of course, we have Bacon's Rebellion, and that changes indentured servants' role, and it increases the need for African slaves. So 80 years later, in the year 1750, half of Virginia's population was black, and of course the big increase is because of Bacon's Rebellion to replace the indentured servants. In South Carolina, there's even greater number of African Americans to whites. So 2-to-1, blacks outnumbered whites, and most of the blacks in South Carolina were slaves. And many of them came over to South Carolina and North America through the Middle Passage. And that was used by slave traders to bring slaves over to the New World, and especially North America. And it was just an awful thing. The Middle Passage was a sea voyage from Africa to America. 20% of all the people who boarded the ship in Africa, 20% of all the slaves, died by the time they got to America months later. And then in 1700, slave codes were developed in America. The first slave codes of the New World were in 1661, the Barbados slave codes. Hopefully that rings a bell to you. And these slave codes were brought up, especially to South Carolina, by the year 1700. And finally, the sad thing about the slavery increase is by the year 1700, slavery obviously was used for the economy, especially the tobacco, the rice, and sugar of America. But also, the racist attitude really started to develop and became a reason for slavery because the white Americans, if you will, thought they were better than the slaves and treated them as such. Okay, here's some very interesting and telling images from the Middle Passage. Again, that was the voyage from Africa to America for these African slaves. And if you just look at this image up here, just look at how they were forced to sleep so close together, no room. It was all just awful. And then just how this is before they would go on the ship, they would round them up and have them sit at the next to the ship and wait to be boarded up, and they're naked and awful. And then, of course, we have some scars on the back of this African slave, most likely because of the white leader would whip him, obviously many, many times to control their behavior. Okay, three more slides to cover. The next section is Africans in America. And let's talk about differences between the Deep South colonies and the Chesapeake in terms of slavery. So rice and indigo became some of the key crops, especially in South Carolina. And the importance of this is that they were difficult for the slaves to work. It was very difficult, back-breaking work, and it was harsh conditions for the slave. It was very demanding. And so the connection here is the deeper you went in the South, or the further south you went, especially South Carolina and parts of Georgia, the worse it was to work the land. However, slaves that dealt with tobacco, mostly in the Chesapeake region, it was much less physically demanding for the slaves. And so if you were a slave, you probably preferred, especially early in colonial America, to be in the Chesapeake region because it wasn't as difficult and hard on your body. Moving on, African culture does mix with European culture and develops their own identity, their American culture, through language, music, dance, and religion. Key thing in Apush, especially up until the Civil War, there are very few slave revolts in American history, and this is also true during the colonial time period. Yes, Bacon's Rebellion does happen, but that is not a slave revolt. That had to do with white indentured servants rebelling against the wealthy Eastern elite. And the few slave revolts in colonial America can't even match up with how big Bacon's Rebellion became. And so the two that you should have an awareness of, the two main slave revolts in colonial America, included the New York City Slave Revolt in 1712 and the Stono Island Revolt in 1739 in South Carolina. So that we've only had two main slave revolts before the Revolution, and both were unsuccessful. The slaves did not accomplish what they wanted. And I think this is important evidence to show that slaves were more manageable than white indentured servants. So because there was very few slave revolts, it showed that slavery, that slaves could be controlled. It was about makers of America from African to African Americans. And a couple key things to read over and look at. By 1740, why was the importance of the slave trade decreasing? And then why did Christianity become appealing to many slaves? All right, so to number one, the slave trade is basically bringing slaves over from Africa and selling them as property. And by the year 1740, that actually was going down because in America, most of the slaves were reproducing and they were having children. And so the children of slaves were also slaves, and it became a very profitable business for the slave owner. Thus, they did not need to bring as many slaves over from Africa into America. And finally, just some key things to Christianity and the relationship with slavery. Our religion becomes very important to the slaves, especially Christianity, the stories of Jesus, of Moses, of overcoming difficulties, appeal to the slaves. And also music becomes very important to the slave as well. And jazz music really becomes a part of America, especially in the early 1900s. And a lot of this comes from the southern parts of the United States, especially from former slaves. The final slide for today is the Southern Society in the 1600s. What were the Southern social classes? You need to have an awareness of this from the South. All right, the wealthiest people were called planters, but they were also called the gentry. two different terms mean the same thing. These are the wealthiest people in the South. They are in politics, they had power, and they owned the most number of slaves. Underneath the planters in the social structure were the small farmers, and this is, I would know that the small farmers, by the way, they're also called yeoman farmers. We'll get to that term later. This was the majority of Southerners of this class were the small farmers. Third were the landless whites. Many of these were former indentured servants. They do not own land, and so they're searching for land. They're kind of bouncing around looking for jobs. The fourth social class were the indentured servants. We talked about them already. And then underneath the indentured servants were the slaves. So this is the social class that really starts to develop. And there is a huge gap between the rich and the poor in the South. Finally, there were very few cities that developed in the South. I mentioned Charleston, South Carolina before, Richmond, Virginia. Few professionals, and the key thing about the South with these giant plantations. The life of the South revolved around the great plantations, and because they were so huge in terms of land area, many of these people were isolated from each other, and thus you did not have many towns or schools develop, unlike in the North.